Hello viewers, you're welcome to Sahara TV live, reaching you from New York City, and my name is Omoyele Sowore. To our viewers out there in Nigeria and the rest of the world who are celebrating Easter, we say happy Easter to you. Today we have a very, very important musician from Nigeria. He's a Fuji musician who has been around for a long time. As a matter of fact, I met the guest that I'm about to introduce. 1992, when I was 21 years old. He looks exactly the same way I saw him then today. And the first question I'm going to ask him is his age. But before then, let me introduce you to King Wasiu Ayinde Marshal, known as KWAM One. You're welcome to Sahara TV.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Yes, I promise I'm going to ask your age. Don't feel offended because you just haven't looked different. But we're seeing even video of your daughter, you know, singing for you. That means you have been around for a long time. Yeah. Even though you don't look it. How old are you, KWAM One?
I'm 56.
56. Wow. That's impressive. So, yes, let's ask you, what brought you to New York this time around?
I've been very much around, in and out of New York and U.S., in general, on performance here and there. We've been on this unending musical tour, spreading the gospel of good music like Nigeria is known for. What I play is Fuji music, and the whole responsibility of Fuji lies on my feet now, that it is a must for me to keep on spreading the gospel of that music. And that's why I'm here.
For those people who may not understand, I mean, we broadcast to a wide audience of people around the world. Who say, what is Fuji music? Can you just break it down a little bit? What is it?
Fuji music is a kind of a traditional musical, you know, serious lyrics from coast of Africa and Nigeria. And it has the background first from the religion, the Islamic religion.
Okay.
But when the likes of us came about, all we wanted to, you know, turn for the success of that music is opening the face to the outside world to see the richness in that music, combination of fantastic instrumentation and lyrics back with heavy dancehall.
Wow.
And that is Fuji. Fuji is about dancehall.
Wow. Well, this is Easter in Nigeria. People would think that this is a time that you've been high demand in Nigeria, back at home, where people want you to be performing from, you know, at different levels. You know, how come they let you out of Nigeria at the time that everybody's having, you know, Easter celebration?
Like I said, the gospel of that music now has gone beyond the shore of Nigeria. We've opened the face of it over the years to the world. We've performed at various world musical concerts, world-rated concerts, Raya Festival, Barbican. We've done series of festivals opening the face of Fiji music to the international world. And I tell you, my position now is not about staying back doing one celebration, just one spot. So what we're doing here too, much as they're celebrating Easter in Nigeria, they're celebrating in America.
That's correct. Yes. You just said that the responsibility of leading Fuji lies on your foot. I mean, what do you mean by this? You know, you're like the last man standing.
I am the headship. The spokesperson. I'm everything. I'm all in all. I am, you know, by tutelage, by service, over the years, I've run over 40 years as a Fiji musician.
Wow.
And I am still very kicking.
That I can see that. So do you see your brand of music? Just like when you came to Fuji, you said you opened it up to the world. You introduced a lot of instrument. You brought in new lyrics that, yeah, like you said, it used to be seen as an Islamic kind of music.
But now it's become a global genre of music. Yeah.
And so is that continuing? Do you see younger generation people doing the same thing? Or has has it been diluted?
Oh, no. Oh, yes. The reason why people like us still thanking Almighty God being there is we want to guide the music so well. Because very many good music of the world today, the older player try as much as possible to guide it. Even the hip-hop, the rap, the founding fathers of that genre of music, they're still very much there to guide it. So that's exactly what I'm doing for Fuji music. Guiding, I have a lot of younger performers who are doing very well. And my spirit is to see, by the time I'm handing over finally, the music keep on increasing and it's not dying.
Very good. One question I would like to ask you is politics. We recently saw you twice now. One instance that, you know, there was information that you were running for the Senate out of Lagos. I don't know how correct that was, but the one that we saw and documented was that you actually participated in Occupy Nigeria, the mass protests that happened in Nigeria in 2012, January, over removal of fuel subsidy. And it was a surprise to a lot of people because your kind of music is seen as praising rich people, right? And suddenly you are fighting against the same rich people, and people are wondering, well, you know, what led you to do it?
When I first started as a musician, when I was young, the starting point and the call name of my band is Wasiu Ayinde and his Fuji Revolution. We believe very many things need to be changed. And the only way we can lend voice to that change is when we are there to participate. So the message I spread to the younger generation of Nigerians when I started was for us to rise up in defense of our future. And I'll tell you, I've never rested one beat right from then. You know, I still have the firebrand in me. And if you see me in politics today, I am in politics not per se because of the personal gain, but because of liberation. We want to liberate our people. We want to pass the message as much as possible to our people. We still believe the message has not gotten down to people. You see, for one reason or the other, the leadership of that country still makes, you know, dissemination of information so tight, so blocked, you know, to the generality of people. If people are well informed, definitely the problem we're facing today in Nigeria won't be facing that problem.
Did you come through any backlash? Did the government people threaten you? Did you feel afraid that, you know, participating openly in an anti-government?
You never cannot be afraid because you have a purpose. And the purpose you are doing it, you first understand, is not a purpose of your pocket, it's not towards yourself. I'm not crying out, I'm not antagonizing, I'm not saying all that simply because I want someone to listen to me and offer me something. You know, what I have is rich in everything, you know, to be able to get something for myself. And even if we parley with them, we parley with the leadership so that we could still get the message across to our people and get to them. So like a bridge between the people and the leadership. That's also another point of accepting to either do anything with the government, and it works. It works because you find out not everybody in government that lost their listening ears. There's still very many of them that do listen. They sit with you and they want to ask from your point of view, what do you think we can do to make the life of people better? That touches me when I see leadership asking me that.
Has there been any time that you've been invited to play for someone and you have so much revulsion for maybe their way of life and you turn down?
Very many times.
Regardless of how much you offered.
You see, that money does not matter. Sometimes you have money and you lose the value. So the money doesn't, you know, it doesn't bring that, you know, value to standard that you deem it fit. To want to proudly say, yes, I have this.
One of the things that people talk about musicians, especially when there's more than one person at the top, is that they have rivalry. And now you are the oldest in the Fuji music industry. Business. When, you know, Ayinde Barista was around, or maybe Adewale Ayuba, is there a rivalry between some of you guys? Are there times you, like they say, which we hear about in Nigeria, that you actually go and do juju, you know, to fight yourself so that somebody will lose his voice during the play? Or there will be sometimes that, you know, KWAM One is playing here, Barista is playing on the other end, and on the one side, the rain will be falling, the other side will be dry. I'm just talking about the myth around the rivalry.
Have you had
some of those experiences?
No. I tell you something. It depends on where you're coming from. Where I'm coming from, I am much enlightening than believing in some little things like that, like someone is doing juju, you know, on you. I have this. And while you have this, and you have your firm belief in the, you know, your spiritual, you know, in Ben, you don't lose yourself to that side. Regardless of that, there's rivalry in every business. Mm-hmm. But the truth of the matter is, you know what you are doing and where you're coming from. I know one thing, I senior Adewale Ayuba by the length of service, by age. So that's more than enough for me to even look down on if any shortcomings. Mm-hmm. I just look like a 30-year-old man and a 6-year-old boy. When a 6-year-old boy does something to you, 30-year-old man, if you say because what he does, you want to hit him forcibly like that, people will look at, that's too much of you. Mm-hmm. If that boy there fall you, they say, ooh, you're fall. Yeah. So you take caution.
Yeah.
The rivalry, to the common sense, it doesn't meet.
Yeah.
Rivalry, common sense.
So you apply common sense.
You apply common sense.
All right, let me talk about, you know, the explosion of music in the last 10 years in music. Mm. You found new genres of music, hip-hop, tongolo, you know, you can't count it, everybody comes up with something these days. And has that affected your efficacy in the music world? Do you feel like, oh my God, you know, here comes the band, you know, nice, all these new guys, have they taken away the shine? Have they taken away the thunder from the kind of patronage you get?
No. Unless you who doesn't know what's you, who doesn't know KWAM One, if you know the firebrand, like I said, is still very much in me and it's still kicking. And I have a lot of performances to show every time. I work year round, minimum of 15 performances in a month. You can imagine, so busy. Mm-hmm. I'm busy both in and outside Nigeria. So, and the numbers of artists we still have, or whatever the brand of music that we have today, is still not enough.
Okay, so have you done collaborations with any of the younger guys?
Oh yes, I've done collaboration with a lot. Way back then, I've done collaboration.
I think I want you to collaborate with me on a track called Oga at the Top.
All right.
All right, we'll come back to that. I'm just going to ask you something. That for a period, there was this persistent rumor that you couldn't enter the US, you know, that you couldn't even enter the West. That you had some kind of relationship with guys who patronized you, who were drug, you know, or involved in financial crimes. You know, nobody ever saw this, you know, happen physically. But I'm asking you, for the benefit of those who might doubt this, was there any period that KWAM One was unable to come to Canada or the US?
No, there was never a time.
So it was all rumors?
Well, number one, I would say at a point like I'm so busy back in Nigeria, you know how people, when they wanted you somewhere and you're kind of not, you know, available, they might say probably he was unable to come.
Mm-hmm.
It's just by their imagination.
Okay.
The truth of the matter is, as an artist, you have very many people on the street. A criminal will not write in the forehead that is a criminal.
Mm-hmm.
A drug dealer will not put on the forehead, I'm a drug dealer. Mm. Neither a financial, you know,
crime
you know, offender person, will write over here or will put it on the chest to say, I am this, I am that. And as you know, entertainment, music especially, is open to everybody. Mm. You know, you come in and show, you know, and show your stuff. But the truth of the matter is, I have never in my life dive my hand into very unclean manner of life.
Mm.
Because of what? Because of the lengthening of the time I have been an entertainer, and because of what I have ahead of me. And God's so good. I have my children today, they are doing very well. And they said, watch out, what are you doing? Not because of now, but because of who is taking over from you.
All right.
You can imagine.
Because you mentioned children, actually we have a question on Twitter here who says, you know, it said, KWAM One, we should ask if Fatia Whitney Marshall really is his 38th child. Do you have up to 38 kids?
Don't. That is no. N-O. N-O?
Yeah.
No. But Fatia, it's the youngest of my baby now.
Okay.
Fatia Whitney, that's the smallest of my children.
But it's not number 38.
No.
Are you willing to divulge how many kids you have?
I'm not going to divulge how many kids that I have. But one thing that I know is I do not have 20 children.
Okay.
Less of
38. So it's less than 20. So it's plus 10, minus 20 people. Yeah. I'm going to also ask you another question here, which says, do you have an active charity foundation program? Like, people always say this, you know, in other parts of the world. You make money up to a point. People expect you to give back to society.
I've been doing that way back since I was 3 years old. I've established a foundation.
What's it called?
KWAM Foundation.
Okay.
And that has helped a lot of people. The education, taking care of, you know, very many things in the society. And I'm still doing it, still kicking.
Yeah.
You give back to the society in your own little way. But you don't, if I'm not so loud about it for people to know that, yes, I have this open pocket, but those who benefited from it knows truly they benefited from it.
I will go ahead now ask you, as we're preparing for this show, actually, do you know how many times you perform per year? And we were still at it before we had to. Do you actually, have you thought about it? Like, how many times do you perform per year?
Yeah, like I said, yeah. I said it earlier on. Uh-huh. I said minimum I do about 15 shows a month.
15 shows
a month.
Wow.
That's a lot.
My goodness. So you do weekends? Sometimes you do weekdays?
I do weekdays, I do weekends.
Wow. And sometimes, what do you have times that, you know, you have private performances where some, you know, 10 rich guys just say, you know, come on, we'll just entertain us.
People can do all sort of things to enjoy their life.
Yeah, and you're there to give them.
Some will tell you, I'm having a private in-house party outside the country. Can you give me your time and charge?
Mm.
That's big, though.
Wow. So and then it goes to records now. How many records have you?
I've had over 82 albums in the market.
82 albums.
That spans over 40 years.
Wow, 82
albums.
My goodness, that's a lot of albums. When was the last time you had an album out there?
I had an album 2012.
Okay. So when is the next one coming? That's the question people want to find out from you.
I'm working on my next album now, yeah. And that probably might be by the late end of the year, the fourth quarter of the year.
Actually, there's a question here, you know. So back to the question of politics. One guy asked here, I said, why do you want to get involved in dirty politics? You've worked hard all your life. Do you not know or think that you might lose it all because of politics?
Number one, like I said, the politics I'm into is for liberation. Liberation, because we find out you cannot behind the door complaining. If you are inside, then you want to chip in and says, all I've been complaining about, I'm seeing it, I can see it direct. But the truth of the matter is, for the liberation of your people, I am not going to stake what I should not stake. I'm not going to stake all I've labored for all my life. I'm doing it rightly, and I know where the stopping point is.
Now I'll talk about your World Family and Friends cruise coming up, which is going to start on April 26th from Miami to the Bahamas. So, and it's going to be 26th to the 29th. Are you going to perform every day on that cruise ship? How's it structured?
The taking off of it is on the 26th, and I'm sure the organizer has a series of lines of, programs.
Yeah. Yeah. I see DJ D-Money here and DJ Wally.
They have a lot of other performances. Yeah. And the one I'm going to handle, I'm sure, will be spread out by the organizer, but I'm contracted to be on board the ship 26th through the 29th.
Wow.
So which of the day I'm going to perform, or could it be the whole of the 3 days?
You don't know yet.
Until we get to the water.
And you said that your daughter is coming on this. Which is a big surprise to people that you actually have a daughter who is already in music.
Can you imagine?
What's her name? Can you tell us a little bit about her?
I have four of my children now actively doing seriously music.
Wow.
Oni B is my daughter.
Wow.
And I'll be introducing Oni B on that, you know, family
what
trip.
What kind of, what genre of music does she?
She do a pop.
Wow. So you have three other ones. Tell us.
I have Musty. Mm-hmm. Musty is doing well. He's fire brand.
In Nigeria?
No, he's in Canada.
Okay.
He's in Canada. And I have Sultan is too.
Wow.
He's doing music. And I have Farouk also. Farouk is doing jazz.
Wow, very interesting, very interesting. So when you're done with the cruise, where do you go next? When actually, from here, where do you go next?
From here, I'll be going to Maryland.
Oh, yeah.
I have a show in Maryland tomorrow.
Okay.
And after that show in Maryland, I'll take a break. I take a one-week break. That one-week break will probably enable me to quickly go back home in Toronto and return.
Okay.
Or probably I choose to go to Nigeria. It all depends when I finish tomorrow. Mm-hmm. If I do not have a call back home, then after that, I'm back to prepare for the cruise. And then after the cruise, it goes on and on and on and on.
Another question here is people are asking, how many people do you have on your ensemble of
the band?
How many people?
I have 12-piece band.
Wow. And this is the global band you go with. How many male, how many female?
We have 12 male.
12 male, mm-hmm. And all male band?
All male band.
What happened to females, you know? Especially for someone like you that is known to appreciate women a lot.
But they have no duty to do for me while on stage, except dancing.
Wow.
And
have you tried to find out if there are female musicians who probably can do drums?
I see
if you can assimilate them so that people will not think that you have a band that discriminates against women.
The truth of the matter is, could they have their dedication? Because the holding of them will be through another man.
Well, you never know. You haven't tried it. That's the question. Well, have you ever tried it?
Maybe
female band member.
Maybe the professional ones among them.
Okay.
You know, women for what they are, the probably ones who take care of the home front.
Be a wife to someone.
Maybe not all the children. From where we come from.
Well, you know, I know.
Maybe from here, it workable.
Well, maybe you want to give it a thought, you know.
I think I'll look into that.
So, because it would be great to see there are female Fuji musicians.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, who are doing very well.
Yeah.
Yes, I know about Salawa Beni.
Salawa is doing Waka, so, and she's doing well.
Yeah, so if we can have female Fuji musicians, it definitely can be backup singers.
She has a band.
Yes.
That you can see she introduces, you know, backup singer that are female as well. It works that way.
Absolutely. So, the next question is, of course, Nigeria and where we are today, which we can't do without asking you on this show, because we are very, very political in nature, and we work for the betterment of the country from the outside, too. We are approaching 2015 now. You know, election period is coming, campaigns here and there. But the country seems broken, you know. Like you said, there's no security, the health system is broken, education is not in good shape, the roads are not good. You know, what hope do we have for Nigeria in our lifetime, your lifetime, mine, to undergo any form of change that we can all be proud of? Do you have any hope for...
Hope is not lost about Nigeria getting to the better point. But the problem is we have a sincere mind and firm mind as well to say, I am determined, this is what I want to give back to my people. This time, I'm not thinking about my pocket. I'm not thinking about the volume or the large volume of money or investment or whatever that I'm going to leave for my family. But think about uplifting the standard of living of people, creating a better thing. Every government will tell you they are creating education.
Mm-hmm.
Every government will tell you they are building hospital, but not building hospital. Create an enable environment for investors to come into a community like that of Imeko in Ogun State, or Ifon in Osun or Oyo, or somewhere in Ijebude, or even in Ekpe or Badagry, to say we want to invest our money in healthcare system. This is what we are giving to the society. It could be an investment, but an investment that works over time, that will bring back and yield the dividend and give them interest. Give an enabled environment. We are waiting for that mind to come. Honestly, Nigeria, they're very rich in everything. And the people of Nigeria, they're resilient. It's what other people took for advantage, you know, to kind of insult.
So Nigerians are just too resilient, they're just there, they take all the abuses and they don't fight back.
Because they don't have a choice.
Yeah.
They have no choice.
But they do, because as of January last year, it seems like people like you and several others.
Let me tell you,
together
for the first time.
Yes.
For the first time, in the last 20 years, that incident of 2012 January really make a turning point in my firm belief about Nigeria.
Okay.
When people truly come out, and if we can continue like that, you can see.
Because that's my next question. Is like it seems to have died out.
The rich and the poor, the old, the young, everybody. They have their focus towards one end, and they said, no, I'm going out. Everybody comes out. If we could have an increment of such, you know, such
enthusiasm,
in ourselves,
yeah,
then we'll get there so fast. Honestly, between then and now, maybe some minds, they're back to their share.
Yeah, yeah, because that's a concern. You know, is there any message you have for, you know, new generation of musicians? I know this is a redundant question. Everybody asks you which time you go on the show. Like, you know, what do you advise people if they want to do what you do and remain steadfast and, you know, not have to, you know, not fall apart? By the way, I'm going to ask you an embarrassing question. One of the things that musicians are accused of is that they just don't rely on their personal strengths. You know, that sometimes you need, you know, some kind of a third party support, sometimes drugs, to stay strong.
Unfortunately, no.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, no.
How do you maintain your strength?
I don't smoke. Like I said.
You don't drink?
No, I stopped drinking.
Yeah, you don't womanize.
Womanizing? I don't know. I don't know if womanizing is.
It's not a drug. I just wanted to.
That's not an issue. Womanizing. I see women in large numbers every day. Even if I don't call for it, you definitely they come on your way.
Wow.
You understand? But you see, give respect and due respect to them. But the truth of the matter is, I don't do drug. I don't smoke. Neither do I drink. But the younger generation should just bear in mind they have that future ahead of them.
Mm-hmm.
Whatever you want to do, like they said, what we're doing at all is we're doing well. Just get yourself dedicated to the cause you believe in, and then you keep on, you know, working and working on it. And you see, you get there. No matter how late it is, you get there.
Final question, I would say, because we run out of time, is some of your kids, are there ones that just don't want to do anything about music, and are you letting them be if they're not interested?
Yeah. I have some of my children that are into politics. I have, you know, lawyers among them that is partisan, and they're doing well. They're living their normal life.
Yeah. Mm. Wow. Wakwan, thanks so much for coming on Sarah TV Live.
Thank you so much. It's great to see you again.
Thanks
for the time. Good to see you after such a long time.
Yeah, it's been a long time. And
Thank you so much.
When you do come back to New York, you give us a call.
We'll be
happy to maybe follow you around and see one of your shows. See you in action.
Thank you so much.
So viewers, it's been KWAM 1, King Wasiu Ayinde Marshal 1. On our TV show today. It's been an amazing time talking to him. Again, do not forget that there is a cruise coming up. That's starting from April 26th to the 29th, 2013. It will be taking off from Miami to the Bahamas. That's the best cruise you can be on from the U.S. to the islands. And KWAM will be on standby to entertain throughout, you know, as much as you have more than enough while the cruise is on. And you can always check them out on caucusinternational.com. That's where you can book this cruise if you want to be part of it. caucusinternational.com. It's called the World Family and Friends Cruise. Yes, you know, World Family and Friends Cruise. So if you want to make it, you have to book right now to be able to be on that cruise and to be with KWAM 1 and his daughter and several other talents that are going to be on the cruise. So it's been SaharaTV once again, and do not go away. We'll be back with more programs.